Hi guys, and welcome to another video about ebooks that I got for free from Amazon. This particular one all came to my email under romance. So I don't know if it's paranormal, I don't know if it's dark, I don't know if it's steamy, if it's spicy, if it's historical. It's just romance. That's all I know. It's just romance. So, let's go ahead and just find out together what these are. Okay, this first one is called The Mountain Man's Mail Order Surprise, written by Carla Gracey. This is book number one in the Iron Creek Brides series. This one has 1,480 ratings with an average of 4.46. This one tells me mail order brides and historical romance and Western are the genre tags that I'm seeing. This says, Garrett Harding, and then it has a indigenous name, which I, Wub Shikizi Minidu, is a Chippewa name meaning white spirit. So Garrett Harding is the one I can pronounce knowing that I'm saying it right. So Garrett Harding was orphaned, then found and raised by the Chippewa, whose camp is near Red Lake. His connections to the tribe and his birth heritage meant he was perfectly suited to move between the white towns and the tribe to trade. However, his confusion as to whether he is a white man as he was, born or Native American as he was raised means he never feels connected to either community. So he lives alone between the Indian settlement and the small town of Iron Creek, and only goes to either one for supplies to trade or to the salon to gamble. Or saloon to gamble, I guess is what it is. But he's lonely and he advertises for a bride. Katie Jones is young and alone in Mississippi. Her family have disowned her because she fell in love with the wrong man, married him, and followed him from her home in Richmond, Virginia, as he had found work in New Orleans. He died in the 1878 yellow fever epidemic. Somehow, she managed to survive unscathed. She is desperate with nowhere to flee in order to get away from the epidemic. She writes to a number of men, and Garrett is the only one who writes back to her before her fear of the disease forces her to flee. Will Garrett and Katie form a destiny together, or will a secret she is keeping jeopardize their future together? I must admit, I do get nervous when I see typos in the synopsis on Goodreads, but I don't, it just kind of makes me wonder how many issues there's going to be, editing issues in the actual book, but Goodreads is a completely separate beast, so I really shouldn't hold that, so let's just let that go. So that's that one. Okay. Up next, I have Deck the Headlines, written by Teagan Hart. This one has 270 ratings with an average of 3.95. This one says, obviously, as you can tell where it says Deck the Headlines, it's a play on Christmas. So this is a holiday romance. This one says, 270 ratings with a 3.95 average. If I said that, I'm sorry, that's a repeat. Anyway. She swore she'd never go back to her hometown. He can't get enough of its wacky charm. Thrown together chasing headlines, will the sparks flying between them turn into love? Recently graduated journalist Ella Danforth is right where she wants to be, far away from her hometown of Hope Island, Washington. But in a single morning, she loses everything. Before sundown, she finds herself home for the first time in 4 years to reluctantly take up the recently and mysteriously available post of editor-in-chief for the local paper, the Hope Hornblower. And who does she find in her way? Cal Dixon, a jaded New Yorker fleeing a billionaire merger marriage back home and hoping to get the job himself, the top job himself. The sparks turn to flames as they are forced together to tackle the holidays. A month-long smorgasbord of wacky holiday events designed to titillate tourists ranging from mind fruitcake, midnight fruitcake fights to semi-erotic holiday cookie decorating contests, complete with themed mimosas. Each day they get closer to Christmas Eve, the temperature keeps rising, but will their mutually painful pasts conspire to douse the flames of fire? Let's see, it says this is an enemies to lover, holiday, adult aged, nerdy main characters that will have you laughing out loud, tearing up, and always wanting more. It's told in third person. It is a plot focused, emotional slow burn, happily ever after, with realistic characters and no insta-love. The male main character is a green flag cinnamon roll hero, while part of the Hope Island holiday romance series. It can be read as a standalone and has no cliffhanger. So, good to know that you can read these as a standalone. Anyway, okay. Next up I have Accidentally Aphrodite, written by Dakota Cassidy. And this is part of the Accidentals series. When I got this, I swear on Amazon it said it was book number one in the series, but according to Goodreads it's book number two. So, I'm just switching over to book number one, and we're going to read the synopsis of that just in case you cannot read them separately. I'm going to go with, according to Goodreads, what book number one is, and then eventually I'll acquire book number one and get to there. So, book number one in the Accidental series, again written by Dakota Cassidy, is called The Accidental Werewolf, and that one has 8,763 ratings with an average of 3.67. This one says it's a paranormal romance with werewolves, it's an urban fantasy, shapeshifters, and humor. Okay, so the synopsis of book number one is when Marty Andrews gets bitten by a mangy mutt while walking her teacup poodle, her blonde hair darkens. The hair on her legs starts growing at an alarming rate, and her mood swings put her dream job as a sales rep for Bobby Sue Cosmetics in serious jeopardy. Then a drool-worthy man shows up at her door claiming that he accidentally bit Marty, and since he's a werewolf, she is now too. Thinking Keegan flattery is clearly insane, Marty refuses to believe a word until a kidnapping makes her realize there's more at stake than just her highlights. And she must put her out-of-control life in the hands of the man who makes her blood run wild in more ways than one. So, it does sound like that would be a very comedic series. So, we'll just see if I understand the jokes and the humor in it. And again, I would need to acquire book one, because it doesn't say if I can read them. So if you've read that series, let me know if you can read them all as standalones. Otherwise, I'll just plan on picking up book number one before, obviously, I got book number 10. This next one is called Academy of Protectors, written by Gray Holborn. This is book number one in the Protector Guild series. This one has 737 ratings with an average of 4 stars. The genres listing are reverse harem, fantasy, paranormal, vampires. So it's a paranormal, urban fantasy, shapeshifters, romance. So there's a couple of things. This one says, meet Max Bentley. She's socially awkward, uncommonly naive, and doesn't have a filter between her brain and her mouth, though she's heard great things about them, and is on the hunt for one of her very own, fingers crossed. Oh, and her whole life is about to implode. You know what's annoying? Having your first real date interrupted by a werewolf and hellbound. And while it wasn't exactly swoon-worthy to watch my date get ripped from my lips, luckily for him, I'm pretty great at kicking ass. I doubt I'll get a second date anytime soon, but I have to say that the whole thing wasn't a total waste. What is with my computer freezing? There we go. Okay. Now that the monsters have invaded my small town, my family is finally ready to ditch the secluded cabin I grew up in, with nothing but a fat stack of books and a TV to keep me and my brother from dying of boredom, greener pastures. I've always dreamed of joining the Protector Guild, a secret establishment that studies captured demons and trains protectors to kill them. And when I enroll in the Guild Academy, designed to train protectors to hunt and escape creatures from hell, I'm convinced I'm finally going to find my place in the world. just like the protagonists in all the books I've devoured. But I quickly learned that things in the guild aren't at all what they seem, and I've been fed a steaming stack of lies my whole life. Maybe the old isolated cabin wasn't so bad after all. At least back home, I knew who I could trust. Sort of. After meeting a team of mysterious protectors who are way too good-looking to be trustworthy, it's up to my new friends and enemies to keep the very demons I'm supposed to be chasing after from chasing me instead. Great. So much for that new and exciting life I've always wanted. Clearly, there's such a thing as too exciting, and that whole careful what you wish for thing might have some merit. Says it's the first book in a series, it's slow burn, poly, reverse harem, urban fantasies, and spice. So, there you go. Okay. Moving on, I have Corrupted Heir. This is written by Kiana Hettinger. This is book number one in the Mafia Kings Corrupted series. This one has 2,112 ratings with an average of 4.08. The genres are family, crime, and dark. So, there you go. Okay. The synopsis on this one says, I'm walking down that aisle, whether I like it or not. I learned very early on that every life matters. No life is insignificant. Most especially not my own mother's, whose life was cruelly slain. I vow to do what I can so that no one has to feel as if they're nothing at all when they lose their loved ones. So when I'm forced into a marriage with Dominic Luca, the man next in line to be the head of the biggest crime family in all of New York, the ring he puts on my finger is a gun to my head with his finger on the trigger. I couldn't possibly hold his hand knowing it is the blood of countless men on it. Or it has the blood of countless men on it. I couldn't possibly look into his eyes, knowing he's seen more deaths than a coroner. I could never feel safe around him, especially not after a horrifying truth comes out. A truth that weaves his past with mine. A truth that makes me realize something even more horrifying than the truth itself. Not only am I married to a killer, I'm married to a monster. So, there you go. So, that one, I do admit, does sound pretty good. Okay, let's go ahead and move on. And this next one is called Fluffy, written by Julia Kent. It is book number one in the Do-Over series. And this one says contemporary humor, chick lit, new adult, but it's a romance. So, an all-new standalone. Okay, so this is a stand... Well, it says it's part of a series, so maybe you can read them all as standalones. I hate when things contradict like that because then it just confuses me. It all started with the wrong help wanted ad. Of course it did. I'm a professional fluffer. It's not what you think. I stage homes for a living. Real estate agents love me and my work stands on its own merits. Sigh, get your mind out of the gutter. Go ahead, laugh, I'll wait. See, that's the problem. My career has used the term fluffer for decades. I didn't even know there was a more lascivious definition of the term until it was too late. The ad for a professional fluffer on Craigslist seemed like divine intervention. My last unemployment check was in the bank. I was desperate. Rent was due. The ad said cash paid at the end of the day. The perfect job. Staging homes means showing your best angle. The same principle applies to making a certain kind of movie. Turns out a fluffer doesn't arrange decorative pillows on a couch. They arrange other soft, roundish objects. The job isn't hard. I mean, it is. It's about being hard. Okay. Or, well, helping the other person to be hard. Okay. All right. Yeah. It's going to be spicy. Oh, man. And that's the other problem, a man. No, not the one of the stars on the movie set. Will Lotham, my high school crush, the owner of the house where we're filming, illegally, in a vacation rental. By the time the cops show up, what I thought was just a great house staging gig turned into a nightmare involving pictures of me with an undressed star. Will rescuing me from an arrest, and a humiliating lesson in my own novice ignorance. I'm just going to say, I don't know how to say it. My job turned out to be so much harder than I expected, but you know what's easier than I ever imagined? Having all my dreams come true. Yeah, that would definitely be nice. Having all your dreams come true. Okay, next up I have Dutch Treat. This is actually book number 2 in the Love in the Lowlands series written by D.E. Haggerty. So I'm going to switch over to book number 1 in Love in the Lowlands, and then I'll just have to get number 1 at some point. So book number 1, again by D.E. Haggerty, is called Dutch Engineered. Book number 1 is a novella, and it's just listed as a romance. So let's go ahead and dive into the synopsis, see if we can learn a little bit more. Will the romance-averse Abby make a go of a relationship when a one-night stand has unexpected consequences? The last thing I expect when I take a job in Holland is to run into Jasper, and I do mean run into, as in smack dab into the delicious specimen of Dutch manhood. I take one look at him and decide he's mine. Not mine as in forever. I don't do forever. Trust me, I know better. But mine for a role in the hay, where do I sign up? Except things don't go exactly as I planned. My sexy times with Jasper end up with some not so sexy consequences. Yikes. How am I going to handle a baby when I've never even been in a relationship before? Okay, so she's pregnant. I'm an engineer. I should be able to skillfully arrange my way out of this situation, but it looks like Jasper is the one who's engineered me right to where he wants me. Gulp. This romantic comedy features an engineering prodigy who is adamant that she is not having a permanent relationship with a man, even if she's carrying his baby, and a nerdy Dutchman who is just determined to change her mind. So, there you go. Next up, I have Royal Catch, written by Kylie Gilmore. This is book number 1 in the Rokers series. Genres listed is contemporary romance, fairy tale retelling, and erotica. So, this one says, a gruff prince in need of a wife, a commoner impersonating a princess, and a bridal competition gone terribly wrong. And then looks like this is going to be told from a dual POV at least. So under Gabriel, it says, I am the crown prince of Vilroy, heir to a kingdom, bound to duty to marry and produce an heir. I expected a quiet arrangement through royal channels. Instead, I got a palace full of women vying for my hand. And how do they win this barbaric game set up by my crafty mother? By figuring out how to save the kingdom's faltering economy. So under Gabriel, it says, I am the crown prince of Vilroy, heir to a kingdom, bound by duty to marry and produce an heir. I expected a quiet arrangement through royal channels. Instead, I got a palace full of women vying for my hand. And how do they win this barbaric game set up by my crafty mother? By finding out how to save the kingdom's faltering economy through a series of challenges. This undignified circus is beneath a man of my stature. Proof being that a saucy, ill-mannered woman wearing body-hugging clothes is in the lead. I could never love someone like that, let alone marry her. Okay, then under Anna, it says the plan sounded simple. I pose as my friend, pick up her inheritance, and return with the cash to keep her out of jail. Apparently being a princess in hiding is no excuse for identity theft. So yeah, I'm not exactly royal. I'm an orphan, a self-made woman, and proud of it. Suddenly, I'm in a battle royale with a bunch of crazy competitive women for riches beyond our dreams. I'm in a time crunch, which means I need to win this competition fast. Only, that means winning over the judge, the smoldering, hot, grim-faced Gabriel. And now I find myself wanting to compete for more than just the money. But could a royal prince ever fall for a commoner like me? So, there you go. This next one I have is called The New Girl. You're going to hear the printer going in a second. So I am sorry about that, but I've got to print what I need to print. So this was The New Girl was written by Jillian Adams. This is book number 1 in the Oak Brook Academy series. This one has 518 ratings with an average of 3.66. This does say it is a boarding school clean romance, and it is YA, and sports is the other tag on there. So this one says, A new girl at school who is serious about her studies. A football player with nothing but fun on his mind. Can two teenagers from opposite worlds find love? Sophie Blake is used to change. She's used to being the new kid at school, but she's never had the privilege of attending a school like Oak Brook Academy. She certainly never pictured herself at a boarding school with kids who have more money than what she could ever imagine spending. Wes Carter's life is pretty easy. He's popular, he's on the football team, and there's no shortage of girls who are willing to spend time with him. Most girls don't seem to challenge him the way that new girl, Fifi, does. Something about the new girl is definitely intriguing. When Sophie stands up to Wes during a playful first encounter and then marches out of the popular kid's secret hideout, she puts her entire school reputation on the line. She's happy with her decision to be true to herself, but why can't she get this dreamy green eyes out of her mind? His dreamy green eyes out of her mind. So, and it looks like this is a series, but it looks like it can be read as all as standalones. So, good to know. Okay, so this next one is called Coming Home to the Valley, written by Ellen Joy. This is book number one in the Prairie Valley series. This has 329 ratings with an average of 4.46. And it says it's a Western contemporary romance. Georgie's life seems to be falling apart, but a return to her hometown has her family and an old flame helping to pick up the pieces. Georgie left Prairie Valley 20 years ago in search of a perfect life in the city, and she found it. That is, until her husband, the governor, is involved in a scandalous affair. Now Georgie's come back to the town with her kids to escape the public eye and crawl into the arms of her mother and sister. Sam, her high school sweetheart, offers some comfort as well. He's just as sweet and handsome as she remembers, although she hasn't forgotten how he broke her heart years ago. As Georgie starts to warm up, she can't help but wonder if the small town she was eager to leave as a teenager may be the perfect place to start over. Perhaps Sam and Prairie Valley deserve a second chance. It says this is a clean romance. It says if you enjoy clean, uplifting stories, then grab this first book in the series. So, clean romance. Definitely good to know. Okay, next up I have The Perfect Man, written by Lynn Dare. This is book number one in the Perfect Man series. 394 ratings with an average of 3.86. And this just says it's a contemporary romance and it's adult. Let's see. It says, welcome to Cape Kismet, where the neighbors are nosy, the bookstores offer an escape, and epic romances abound. A hot date? Try five. Every time a perfect man shows up at my door, I swoon the proper amount and do my best not to stare at his chiseled features and firm jaw. Yes, definitely his jaw. But I, Ellie Amore, have a problem. It's big, gigantic, and not in the good way. None of these men are real. And that version of me, more fake than an author calling herself classy while drinking boxed wine in her yoga pants. Me, that author, is me. I dream of hot men, perfect men, fictional men. These men go into my books, and it's all I need for my messy cat lady living above a bookstore life. I think that would be cat lady living above a bookstore. I think that would be pretty sweet. I wouldn't mind that. Really. It says really in there, and I agree with that. But, okay, moving on. I don't need my brother's best friend checking up on me, the man who brings me tacos, the one who is decidedly not perfect, and his enemy cat, as his enemy cat would tell you, but somehow might just be perfect for me. I'm not sure how it all started or when he decided I was more than a favor to his friend. All I know is Cruz is not a man for my dreams. This time it's different. This time, he's real. Let's see. Plenty of swoons, lots of laughs, and guaranteed HFN ending. HFN. I looked this up yesterday. I know HEA is happily ever after. Let's look up HFN meaning. Happy for now. It's a happy for now ending. Okay, whatever that's going to end up meaning. All right, moving on. The next one is called Finding Mrs. Wrong or Miss Wrong. This was written by Susan Warner. It also has the name of Tori Lynn. Don't know if it's an additional author or a pen name, or if it's Susan Warner is the pen name and it's actually Tony Lynn. I don't know. I'd have to look more into that. So this has 465 ratings with an average of 3.67. And it just lists this one as a contemporary romance. It says, I want to marry you because I know we will never last. Okay. Not quite the wedding proposal a gal wants to hear, but times are hard. Alyssa Dane's catering business is about to go belly up unless she finds an influx of cash and a business plan to save it. Mr. I've Got Money looks and can have any woman I want, aka Liam Butler, has discovered that he's a money magnet for gold diggers who aren't interested in his heart, unless it's the key to his bank account. While the wild billionaire might look good in the press, it's causing his board members to wonder if Liam's the one to run Butler Hotels, a multi-billionaire dollar company. So came the proposal. Alyssa would help him look all stable and dignified by marrying him for a short period. Then he would, when the board had finished their evaluation, Liam and Elsa would divorce and he'd help her set up by working in one of his five-star hotels. That is how it all came about, that Alyssa was marrying the man who dumped her in college and never looked back. Nothing goes as planned, and a fake romance starts to feel like the real deal. Could it be that instead of finding Miss Wrong, Liam has found Miss Right? I was going to say, it's a romance, and it sounds like it was going to be like a marriage. It's a marriage of convenience, but they're going to fall in love. So that's what it sounds like. Okay. Next up, I have The Mackinnon's Bride, written by Tanya Ann Crosby. This one has a lot of ratings. This is book number one in the Highland Brides series. This has 11,756 ratings with an average of 3.95. So almost a 4-star for that many ratings. Okay, the tags on this one, obviously it's a romance. It says historical, medieval, and Scotland. So there you go. That kind of gives you some hints of what we're going to be looking at with this one. When Laird Lane Mackinnon's young son is captured by the English, the fierce Scottish chieftain retaliates in kind, capturing the daughter of his enemy to bargain for his son's return. Fiercely loyal to kin, Lane never imagines any father could deny his child, or that he would become Paige Fitzsimmons' savior. Keep her or kill her, Fitzsimmons proclaims when Lane forces his hand. Well, that sucks. To be the daughter where it's like, either keep her or kill her, I don't want her back. That's awful. So what else should a good lad do but carry the lass home? Without telling her the truth, her father doesn't want her. But even as Paige blames her reluctant champion for welching on a bargain with her father, she suspects the truth. The shadows hold secrets and danger. Not only love can save Mackinnon's fiery new bride. Oh, now only love can save the new bride. So that's awful to know that you're not wanted by your own parent like that. That's awful. Okay, next up I have Acts of Closure. This is written by N.T. Anderson, and like not today, N.T. N.T. Anderson. Book number one in the Acts series. This has 42 ratings with an average of 4.48. And the only tag is romance. That's the only tag here on Goodreads. It says, have you ever wondered what if? I think everyone does. Natalie has been waiting for this moment for 20 years. Standing on Jack's doorstep, she's about to come face to face with a man she's never met. Someone who charmed her from a distance without even knowing it. The stories from a mutual friend lit the spark. An anonymous internet fling in the early days of social media kindled the fire. Shared intimacies and secret desires fanned the flames. But that was years ago, and their lives moved on. Jack's dream of conquering Hollywood becomes a reality. Staying cloistered away in his own world, he finds success behind the scenes. Natalie opts for family and her career. Every day, everything working out as it should, until her husband makes a change that throws her life off balance. Now she's wondering, what if? And she's about to find out. In a bold, calculated move, fixed on discovering if Jack is still harboring the pain of his past, Natalie travels to the northeast in search of the answer. Compelled to finally meet the man who has been invading her dreams, she needs to know where the path she didn't follow may have led. One way or another, she needs closure. So we'll see what happens there. Okay. This next one looks like it's a short story. It's 110 pages, so a novella. And this one is called Love in the Cards. It says it's a sweet and clean, small-town, second-chance romance. By Buffy O'Claire. And, I mean, that's literally all... I mean, that's not even in a tag. It's just along right next to the title. This one has... Excuse me. Pardon me. Oh, man. 21 ratings with an average of 3.9 stars. Three friends, three tarot cards, one 10-year reunion. Is there love in the cards for one of them? Maya couldn't wait to get out of Cherryville. She left for university and never looked back, until Maya's husband leaves her. If that wasn't enough, she loses her job, too. Now she finds herself back in her small town 10 years after she left. She agrees to help two old friends open a tapas bar and ends up working alongside her high school sweetheart, Dustin. Can they get out of their own way and choose each other all over again? Now, it looks like it may get spicy because it says choose your spice. Stop at the end of the story for a Hallmark moment or read on for a little extra heat. So maybe there's an extra story, or from Maya's perspective, it's clean, but then it goes to Franny and it might get spicy. So let's read this little bit. And it says, Franny retrieved her purse from under the bar and plucked it on top. She fished around inside. I've got my cards right here, ladies. Care for a reading. I hate it when it just quotes things right from the book, so I'm not going to continue on. So if it's just told from Maya's perspective and then ends, then that's the sweet part. And then if it goes into Franny's perspective, then it looks like that's where it's going to get spicy. So at least that's what it looks like on Goodreads. I don't quote me on that because I don't know for sure. Okay, let's go ahead and move on because that confused me. Heart of Steel is the next book, written by Demelza Carlton, Heart of Steel series. It looks like this is book number one, and this has 387 ratings with an average of 3.57. So, it says this is a paranormal, demons, supernatural romance. And the synopsis is really short. It says, she never expected to summon a demon this sinfully sexy. Carlene swore off witchcraft for good when she arrived at the Swan River colony. But when her home is attacked, she's forced to consult her spell book for the help of a paranormal protector to keep her safe. Only the smoking hot demon she suffers has more than just protection on his mind. So nothing to really go off other than it's going to have paranormal witchcraft. Demon stuff. So that's all I know. Okay, this last book I'm going to tell you about in this particular video is called Off Limits, and this was written by L.A. Cotton, like Los Angeles, L.A. L.A. Cotton. This is book number one in the Rixon High series. So maybe it's a YA? I don't know. Let's see. It does say high school, but then it says new adult, but it also says young adult. So I'm not sure, and then it says college, so I'm not exactly sure if it's going to start in high school and then transition over to college. I'm not sure. It also has the tag of football, so this is also going to have sports in it. So I don't know if this is going to have spice or not, but obviously the characters are going to be pretty young. From the best-selling author, okay, new spin-off generation series, let's see. Okay, Lily Ford has always been a wallflower, but it's senior year and she wants nothing more than to try and push her boundaries and embrace the last year of high school. Caden Thatcher has always been the star on the football field, but now he finds himself in enemy territory, forced to prove himself to his new coach and teammates. It starts with a dare, 7 minutes of heaven in a boat shed, but it quickly turns into something neither of them saw coming. He's everything she should resist. She's everything he shouldn't want. But neither of them are willing to walk away because together, their demons seem that little bit easier to silence. There's just one problem. Lily is the coach's daughter and 100% off limits. So I'm not sure exactly what to think of that. See, and that's one thing I hate on Goodreads when it gives two different age ranges, like middle grade and YA, then it's like, okay, well, which one is it? And in this case, it says YA and it also says new adult. Again, which one is it? I have no idea. Obviously in YA, I don't expect any spice. In adult, that sounds like I would expect it, you know, unless it says sweet or clean or something like that. But so I don't know what to expect with that one. And that kind of just irritates me when it does stuff like that. So anyway, let me know if you've read any of these books, if you've read from any of these authors. Just talk to me about some of what you're thinking or whatever in the comment section below. And until next time, stay true to yourself and enjoy a good book. And I'll talk to you later.